Okay, part two. Let's continue on. So I left you with a bit of a cliffhanger. We decided that we want to reset the form, and to do that, we need a special object for form. We have one for the errors, so why don't we create another one for the form itself? And now we want a method called reset. But we still don't know how to do that because the form doesn't contain the name. So do we want to try to reach back into the form? So for example, we accept the VM, and then we would do something like that. Yeah, I mean, that's an option, but maybe we're thinking about this differently. If we have a new form class, it should be responsible for all of its fields, right? So maybe instead of doing it here, we're now just going to have a reference to form, where we new up a form, and then we pass through any of our data that should be reactive. So we'd have, for example, a name and a description. Now those are going to be stored here. Okay. So if we come back, it looks like we need a constructor that will contain the data. And then we want to, well, we could just do this data equals data, but then in order to access, for example, the name, I'd have to say this.data.name. I just want to do this.name, or in other words, form.name. So why don't we do this? Why don't we say for let field in data, this field equals data field. So yeah, like if we have name equals nothing here, we're going to filter through it. Field is now equal to the string name. So we attach this.name equals, in this case, just nothing. Okay, so now if we come back, yeah, that's how our form is going to look. So let's just go to Chrome and see what's going to blow up here. Open up Chrome DevTools. Okay, property or name method is not defined on the instance, but is referenced during render. So the issue is, right now, if we go to any of our inputs, think of this one. VModel should no longer point to name. It should point to form.name. So let's try to update this. Form. And then the same thing here. Next, we'll do it here. Form.description. Okay, let's give this a refresh. And if we go to our view instance, root, we now have a form object where we have the original data, but also, if we scroll down and fill these out, we still have our original data binding. So this is good. But next, think about it. If we go back to app.js, a form object right here should expose the behavior that it can be reset, but maybe it also exposes the behavior that it can be submitted. Cool. So if that's the case, maybe our Axios call could be contained here. Now things are getting interesting. But even more than that, notice we have errors here. What is this? This is a pointer to the form errors. So maybe form can be responsible for storing that. Maybe form could say this.errors equals new errors. That coupling and that connection makes a little more sense, doesn't it? So that means I could get rid of this entirely. And now whenever I need a form, I just new up my form and pass through any of the fields that I have. But now we're going to have this new issue where it's going to fail again, right? Property or method errors is not defined on the instance because once again, we would have to say form.errors, right? So let's go back. Yeah. Okay, so why don't we find all of our instances and update this to form.errors. Give it a refresh, and now those go away. Great. So if we take a look at our structure now, and if we fill things out, the description, the name, and then a list of errors that have been assigned. Let's try it. Create, but it fails. Let's see. So we got a 422, cannot read property record of undefined. So once again, we just need to update a reference here. Errors is not stored on our view instance. It's now stored on the form. So one more time, we will fill this out. Console. So we do get a 422, but we don't see the errors, which means we must not be spitting them out properly. But we can see, yep, there they are. All right, so that means we need to go back to our view. And let's see, if the form errors has, and whoops, it looks like maybe we were too generous with that search and replace. We're still just checking for a single column here. Okay, one more time, and now it's working. So if we start typing, they disappear. So yeah, this was a pretty good migration, and I think it's actually going to clean it up quite a bit. We have one class responsible for the form, and even submitting the form. And then we have another class that can be responsible for error management. Then our view instance, our VM, we can reuse this from form to form, and that's when it's really going to begin to save you time. If you just have like a single form for a little static site, then this is overkill for sure. But when you end up having a dozen forms for a site, you're really going to be thankful for this, because you won't have to reproduce the same logic over and over. So let's come back and flesh this out. If we want to reset the form, well, we can't just say this data equals an empty object, because really this is a pointer to the original data. All of the items that have reactivity are just stored directly on the form. But then we also have things like errors and potentially something else that's not related to the data object. So maybe what we could do is filter through the original data and then update the properties on the form, like this. For let field in original data, then find the field off of the current instance, and then just update it to an empty string or null or whatever is appropriate. Now, if we scroll down, once we have successfully submitted the form, we can reset it and it will clear those fields. Okay, next, so let's see where we are on the AJAX end. So when we submit this form, we call an onSubmit method, and that triggers this. But we've decided that maybe it would be cool to let the form be responsible for submitting itself, in which case we would say something like this.form.submit. Maybe we give it the request type, and then an endpoint, which would be projects. Now, this junk here could be stored up here. Request type and URL. All right, let's paste that in. So our AJAX library will now post to the URL, but we need to make that dynamic as well. That way, if it's a patch request, then it will end up being this. And what you could even do then is add helper methods like post to a URL, and then that will delegate here. That kind of stuff can be really useful, but I'm going to skip it. So post to the URL, we're no longer going to use the data. We're going to use some kind of data method on this class. So let's add this up here. That will have to figure out what the data payload should be. Then we're going to have an onSuccess method and maybe onFail as well. So catch this.onFail. And we can grab all of this junk here where we accept the error. And then we update this, this.errors.record, like so. But there is one issue. When these get called, the this context, as you may know, it gets rebound. So this is no longer going to refer to our form object. So what we can always do is just bind it. So call on success, but I want to make sure that we bind the this keyword to the current instance. Okay, so now we will alert the message. This is, of course, entirely temporary. You wouldn't store that here. Alert response.data.message. And then just to be safe, what we also might want to do is ensure that the errors are empty. Now, I think they should be at this point, but just to be sure, we could say something like this.errors.clear. And we already have a clear method, right? Let's scroll up. That's to clear a field. Maybe we can say if you gave us a field, then delete that single field. Otherwise, just update errors or reset it entirely. Make sense? Okay, so the next step, we got to figure out what the data is. And this is where it gets a little tricky, because the data would be this.name and this.description. But that needs to be dynamic, right? We can't hard code that. So how do we do this? And also, we can't just fetch all of the properties off of this object, because once again, we have errors and original data and anything else you assign. So why don't we do this? We could clone this object using object.assign to an empty array and then pass this. So this is basically going to clone the object. And that would basically be an object now that has name, description, but it would still have original data and errors. So yeah, I mean, again, there are lots of little toolkits and libraries that can help you with this and cloning it and omitting items. Why don't we just delete it? So we'll say clone it, but then we don't care about data.originalData, and we don't care about data.errors. Yeah, maybe there's some other ways to do it, but I think that'll get the job done. So now, this should be exactly the payload that we care about, and we'll pass that through to our post request. Okay, so now, if we scroll down to our VM, this, remember, this stuff we're creating here, this is sort of like your own little framework. You create it once, and then you tuck it away in its own file. And then for every other view model, this is all you're working with. You create a new instance of your form, and then you listen for the form to submit, and then you just delegate. You tell the form, all right, you had the data, you're using vModel to bind all of the necessary values. So go ahead and submit a post request to /projects. That means I can get rid of this entirely. And it's much simpler. Look at this. All right, let's see if we made some errors. I assume we did. So console, that looks good. New name, new description, or let's leave one blank. So request type is not a function. So what were we passing there? Post, and we scroll up to the form. So that's trying to do, you know what it is? It needs to be lowercase. I bet that's exactly it. Library post, yeah. Yep, that's it. Okay, fair enough. And again, that's why it would be useful to create little helper methods, so you don't even have to think about that. But anyways, let's give it another shot. Create, and there we go, it works. We start typing. Submit, let's go to network tab and empty these out. Okay, now we run it and project created. If we take a look, it all worked. Oh, but you know what we didn't do? We forgot to reset the form. We added this handy dandy method here, but we never called it. So why don't we say this.reset? Okay, so now when we have successful form submission, we do a little alert, we clear out the errors, we reset the form that will filter through all of the fields in the original data, and then empty them out. All right, run it, create, alert, and now those are emptied out. Otherwise, we submit it, it fails, the button is disabled, and we have to fill each one out before we can submit it. But you know what? I think that was an issue. We start typing, and now we get rid of the message for all of them. That's not what we want. We have a little regression here. So when we key down form.errors.clear event.target.name, and if we switch back to errors.clear, Oh, you know what that is? We're deleting it, and then we just move on and reset it entirely. I bet you even saw that, and you're like, Jeff, you're such an idiot. So we try this, and that should fix it. Fails, type, and now it only empties that one. So the button's only re-enabled once you've reset each input. All right, so you know what? I think we're going to call it. I would actually expand this a good bit more, but I think I'm going to leave this to you. I want you to try to implement this in an actual form on your website and figure out what other things you might want. I'll give you some examples. Maybe you want to detect when the form is submitting and then change the button down here to be like an AJAX loading button. Well, maybe you could use a class, like you dynamically add the class isLoading. But you only do that if the form is currently submitting or is working. Maybe that can be a keyword you could use in your form class. This is the fun part where you get to do it on your own. So I will make this source code available to you, and it's now over to you. Have fun.